Thank you. That concludes general questions. The next item of business is First Minister's questions. And at question number one, I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Yesterday, the government finally found the missing documents in their ferry fiasco. For a brief moment, it looked like islanders and taxpayers here in Scotland might finally get the answers they deserve. But they didn't. For weeks, Nicola Sturgeon has stood in this chamber and told MSPs that Derek Mackay signed off the vital contract for Ferguson Marine to build replacement ferries. But Operation Blame Derek Mackay has a fatal flaw. This new document, previously hidden from the public, reveals that the person who signed this deal at the final stage was the Deputy First Minister. Civil servants escalated this to John Swinney. They waited for the Deputy First Minister to give the green light. Honest John's hands are all over this dodgy deal. First Minister, how do you explain blaming Derek Mackay when your own documents confirm that John Swinney signed off this deal?
First Minister. I think all that Douglas Ross is displaying right now is his own utter desperation, which perhaps is not surprising given events since we last all gathered here for First Minister's questions in the chamber. Let me just read from the emails that were published yesterday. The important one, and remember, and people who have listened to this will remember that I said that I thought if this email could be found, then what it would be is a one-line email saying that the Minister was content with the proposal. So here's the Minister from Derek Mackay's, here's the email from Derek Mackay's office. The Minister is content with the proposals and would like it to be moved on as quickly as possible. That was the decision to proceed with the contract. And then the email from the official who had briefed the Deputy First Minister. The Deputy First Minister now understands that Mr Mackay has cleared the proposal. So it seems pretty obvious to anybody who is looking at this. The Deputy First Minister did not take the decision. He wasn't even copied in to the advice of the 8th of October that was the basis of that decision. He was simply briefed on the decision after it was taken, not even at his request, but on the initiative of an official. It is not unusual, really not unusual, for finance secretaries to be briefed on all sorts of decisions that involve the spending of money. It does not mean that the finance secretary has actually taken the decision. Now, I would say, Presiding Officer, that Douglas Ross should know that's how government works. But of course, Douglas Ross doesn't know how government works. And on recent evidence, Douglas Ross is unlikely to ever know how government works. Douglas Ross.
It seems from that answer that the First Minister doesn't know how emails work, because it's very clear in here how officials escalated it to John Swinney, waiting for his green light. And in these emails, civil servants state that the Deputy First Minister confirmed, and this is a quote from these emails from First Minister, the absence of banana skins. John Swinney couldn't find a single banana skin when they were absolutely littered around him. There were more banana skins in this project than there are in the monkey house at Edinburgh Zoo. And now, the latest incompetence from this SNP government. They published a series of responses to the request for more information that were heavily redacted, lines blacked out. Except they've done such a poor job at redacting the documents, if you copy and paste them into Microsoft Word, the information is revealed. In one section of the redacted document, it warns of a risk of legal challenge for this contract. It states, and I quote, the impact of a successful legal challenge could be high. In the worst case, the contract could be declared ineffective. In other words, going ahead with this contract was such a bad idea, it could open up the government to even more losses than they've already experienced. First Minister, it's clear to everyone now why you and your government wanted that redacted, but it's now in the public domain. So tell us, we all knew this was a bad deal. Was it also unlawful?
First Minister.
I think Douglas Ross has no doubt unwittingly just holed his own arguments below the waterline, pardon the pun. Two matters here. Firstly, on the Deputy First Minister not seeing any problems with the award of the contract. That's because the Deputy First Minister had not been copied into the paperwork that formed the basis for the decision. So the Deputy First Minister couldn't have been the person taking the decision because he wasn't copied into the 8th of October paperwork. He wasn't the decision taker. As the
members,
as the members makes clear, he was briefed on the decision after the Transport Minister had taken the decision. And secondly, on the issues of legal challenge, ministers are briefed on many, many issues that decisions could be subject to legal challenge. On some occasions, the minority of occasions, that comes to pass. On most occasions, that doesn't. And these are issues that ministers have to weigh up in reaching decisions. But where I think Douglas Ross undermines his own case here is that in this, it didn't come to pass, of course, that the contract was legally challenged. So ministers weigh up all of these issues and they come to decisions. And what is now beyond any doubt whatsoever, and I suspect this is what is really annoying Douglas Ross, is that the minister who took that decision was Derek Mackay, and that is now clear from the email chain.
Douglas Ross.
That is not clear, First Minister. In fact, the exact opposite is clear. And maybe the stony silence from John Swinney today, which is unusual in these exchanges, is telling in itself. But there we have it. There we have it, Presiding Officer. The SNP's Secret Scotland, foiled by copy and paste. You can't even redact documents properly. It's little worry these ferries aren't on time and on budget. So, CMAL warned you about the risks. We now know your own legal advice was this was high risk, but you went ahead anyway, and taxpayers and islanders are paying the price for your failures. Yeah. These new emails state John Swinney understands the background and the way is clear to award. If he doesn't clear the deal, it doesn't go ahead. That's what these emails say. Yeah. He went ahead knowing, as we've just revealed, that it could open the government to legal challenge. So we now know all of this, but what we still don't know is why the Deputy First Minister ignored all those banana skins. The most crucial document in this affair is still missing. The one that explains why John Swinney charged ahead against expert advice. Yeah. Last night, Audit Scotland said this. There remains insufficient documentary evidence to explain why the decision was made to proceed with the contract, given the significant risks and concerns raised by CMAL. Mm-hmm. So will the First Minister tell us, why did John Swinney go ahead with this deal against the advice of experts when he knew that this contract was so bad it could be challenged in court and rendered ineffective?
First Minister.
Well, 3 points, Presiding Officer. Firstly, in government, finance secretaries are very often briefed on decisions that involve the spending of money. In this case, of course, the budget had already been approved by John Swinney. Secondly, it's interesting because he has to do this to sustain the case he's trying to make here. Douglas Ross has selectively quoted from the email from the official who did brief John Swinney. So let me read the bits that Douglas Ross read out. The email starts, just finished my call with the Deputy First Minister, who of course was Finance Secretary at the time. Douglas Ross read out these bits. He now understands the background and the way is clear to award. Let me read out the bit that Douglas Ross didn't read out. So after he now understands the background, it goes on to say, and that Mr. Mackay has cleared the proposal. Now, had Douglas Ross read out that bit, of course, his entire argument here would have fallen to pieces. So it is a bit misleading, I think, Presiding Officer.
Desperate.
And lastly,
members... members.
I'm not sure, presiding officer, Douglas Ross should be speaking to any other leader right now about their backbenchers. Yeah. I suspect he might have issues rather closer to home. Finally, presiding officer, the reasons for the decision are clear. The basis for the decision, in particular, the mitigations that had been put in place to address the risk of no refund, full refund guarantee, are set out in the paperwork of the 8th of October. Now, without the email that we now have from Derek Mackay, we could have assumed that that was the case, but I accept we didn't know that for sure. But now that we have that email, it is clear that the decision that was taken on the basis of all of the information and the mitigation set out in the paperwork of 8th of October 2015. That is paperwork that wasn't copied to John Swinney, that went to Derek Mackay as Transport Minister, and Derek Mackay took the decision. That is clear to anybody who reads the emails that are now published.
Douglas Ross.
What is clear to anybody and everybody from these emails is the junior transport minister agreed something and it was escalated to the deputy first minister for the green light, for approval, so they can put in this email the way is clear to award. That was from the deputy first minister. He had to sign it off. But the documents that's still missing is the crucial one. The one that explains why John Swinney did this. Now, the First Minister has forgotten, her memory's gone blank again. But the good news is, the man with all of the answers is literally sitting right next to her. If the First Minister won't tell us all of the details, let's hear from the Deputy First Minister. Let's hear why he chose to ignore expert advice. Let's hear why he forged ahead with a deal that has cost taxpayers £250 million. And, presiding officer, let's hear why John Swinney decided to give the green light to a deal that opens this government up to potential legal action. The stench of cover-up and corruption is running through this whole sorry affair. If the First Minister won't come clean, if she won't come clean, let's get John Swinney on the stand. Will the First Minister agree to the Deputy First Minister appearing? Will the First Minister agree to the Deputy First Minister appearing before Parliament today to give a statement in this chamber today to face scrutiny and tell the public what on earth he was thinking?
First Minister.
It's not my job to help out desperate Douglas Ross, frankly, presiding officer. The Deputy First Minister on this issue was briefed as Finance Secretary because a decision had been taken by the Transport Minister that involved the spending of money. That's why it's finance officials a finance official that briefed him. I would repeat again, presiding officer, that Douglas Ross has only been able to sustain, and I don't think he's done it particularly well, his argument today by selectively quoting from an email, by missing out the crucial words that show, that underline what is already clear in the email from Derek Mackay's office, that Derek Mackay took the decision. And finally, I don't know if Douglas Ross has actually bothered to read all of the paperwork on this. I suspect from his questions the answer to that is no. But the paperwork that shows why the decision was taken has always been there. It is the paperwork of the 8th of October 2015. And what we now know is that Derek Mackay took the decision on the basis of the advice set out there. That is the fact. I'm sorry if Douglas Ross cannot accept those facts. I'm sorry if he is too desperate to do so. But that, I'm afraid, is his problem.
Question number two, Anna Sarwar.
Can the First Minister confirm how many investigations into bullying by current or former SNP Cabinet Ministers there have been, if those investigations have concluded, and what the outcomes of those investigations are?
First Minister.
I was indeed asked this question by journalists over the course of the last few days, and as I made clear to journalists, I am not in a position to get into these issues, because there are very considerable legal data protection issues that I am bound by. Governments have a duty of transparency, but governments also have a duty to abide by the law on privacy and on data protection. A complaint, by its nature, includes personal detail data of both the complainer and the person complained about. This personal information can only be made available out with the narrow confines of the complaint if there is a lawful basis within GDPR to do so. That is UK legislation, not legislation passed by this Parliament. So yes, there is a duty of transparency, but there is also a duty to abide by the law. Finally, on this, Presiding Officer, Anna Sarwar should perhaps confer with his deputy, Jackie Bailey, because she, of course, was the one of the co-authors of a report published by a committee of this Parliament last year, of course, into complaints about another former minister. And I'm going to quote from that report. The committee believes that the fundamental principle of any complaints process is that confidentiality must be observed. The Scottish Government has a duty to ensure the confidentiality of the process. Confidentiality of an investigation is of paramount importance. That's what the committee of this Parliament said, and of course those are the constraints that I answer these questions within.
Anna Sarwar.
That committee also found the First Minister guilty of misleading this Parliament. I don't think she should forget that either. But no one is asking the First Minister to reveal confidential details. What they're saying is to reveal the outcome of that investigation. So the First Minister didn't answer the questions. Let me quote, we have to lead by example, we have to show leadership, and we have to make it very clear that those that work in this Parliament, those that work elsewhere in society, need the fullest protection from bullying. That's SNP leader Ian Blackford at Westminster in regards to the Preeti Patel case. And I agree with him. After the allegations against Alex Salmond, and then Derek Mackay, and the bullying findings against UK government ministers, we need to restore trust in politics. And that must start with complaints being handled transparently. So I ask the First Minister again, will she today confirm the outcome, not the personal details, the outcome of the bullying investigation into Fergus Ewing? Can she confirm if there have been any other investigations into current and former Scottish ministers? And will she commit to make public the conclusion of any and all complaints upheld against ministers in this government?
First Minister. Well,
firstly, I and this government take any complaints about any ministers very seriously. That is evidenced by both the development and the publication of the updated procedure for handling complaints made by civil servants, either about current or about former ministers. So this is not a question of any complaints, if they are raised, not being investigated. But that has to be done within the law. I have to abide by the law. I have a duty to uphold the law, and there are laws here on privacy and data protection that apply. And if I answer questions on this, I will be at risk of breaching that law, and I'm sure next week or the week after that, Anas Sarwar or his colleagues, of course, will be asking for me to be held to account for doing that. So these are serious issues. They have to be treated seriously, but they also have to be treated within the confines of the law that applies.
Anas Sarwar.
Let me be very clear. I'm not asking for the data. I'm not asking for the personal details of the person making the complaint. Yep. What I'm saying is the public deserve to know the outcome of an investigation relating to ministers in the SNP government. That's an issue of public transparency. Because the fact that Nicola Sturgeon can't escape from is that her government and this SNP operate in a culture of secrecy and cover-up. It's not the first time we've heard it today. Cover-up when it comes to allegations against ministers. Cover-ups when it comes to the awarding of government ferry contracts. Shamefully cover-ups when it comes to the deaths of children in hospital, and a culture that is contempt for journalists and anyone who dare ask a difficult question of this First Minister. One standard for them and another standard for everybody else. One where an SNP MP can avoid being disciplined for sexual harassment and instead lead a parliamentary debate on the subject. In 2003, Nicola Sturgeon said of the then Scottish Government, they have the arrogance of a party which has been in power for too long and no longer believe the common values of decency, fairness and honesty apply to them. I can't think of a more appropriate way of describing this government led by Nicola Sturgeon. After 15 years of being in government, why does Nicola Sturgeon think it's one standard for her and another standard for everyone else?
First Minister.
Firstly, Presiding Officer, the people of Scotland have had two opportunities in just a year to decide whether they think my party has been in government for too long or not, and I think their answer on both occasions was pretty clear. But these issues are important, Presiding Officer. So firstly, on issues on the Queen Elizabeth Hospital, of course, I'm so opposed to transparency there, I've actually, with my government, established a full independent statutory public inquiry into these issues. On questions from journalists, I stand to be corrected if somebody can challenge me on this, but I've probably answered more questions from journalists over the past couple of years than any other political leader anywhere on these islands. Thirdly, ended up the subject of investigations over the last couple of years because I wasn't prepared to cover up accusations against a former minister. Exactly. The fact is, though, I have to abide by the law. All parties, whether I like it or not, have rights under data protection law that protects their personal data, and that includes the fact or the detail of complaints. Processing of that data can, under the law, only occur if there is a lawful basis to do so. So that is the legal position. Yes, governments have a duty of transparency, and I take that very seriously. But governments also have a duty to abide by the law on privacy and data protection. Absolutely. And if we breach that law, Anas Sarwar would be one of the first standing up here to accuse us of doing so.
We'll now move to constituency and general supplementaries, and I call Joe Fitzpatrick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister and others across the Chamber will, I'm sure, join me in condemning reports of sexist, racist and homophobic comments at the Scottish Football Writers Association gala dinner and offer support to those who walked out in protest. Whilst recognising the apology that has been issued, does the First Minister agree that this appears to be a shocking illustration of the outdated discriminatory attitudes that still exist in football and indeed in journalism that need to be eradicated?
First Minister.
Yeah, I very much agree with those sentiments from what I've read of what occurred at that particular awards dinner. It was unacceptable, and I would pay tribute to Ailey Barber and others who I think very courageously took a stand against that and spoke out. It's not easy ever for any woman in particular in a traditionally man's world to speak out in that way, and I think Ailey and her colleagues deserve credit for doing so. I think we've seen over the past week, that is one example, I think there has been another reported that sexism and misogyny still runs far too deep in our society, and it is a reminder that it must be tackled, but it is also a reminder that it starts with male behaviour, and it's male behaviour that we must see change.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister may be aware that the timetable for the new Reston station in my constituency doesn't include adequate evening services, and this is a problem for my constituents. Rages have said that there are no plans for ScotRail to provide evening services, and it's for Transport Scotland to confirm. So we've got an issue with 40% of cancellations of trains to Tweed Bank from Edinburgh, which is caused by the pay dispute, and now we've got no evening services for my constituents. Will the First Minister confirm that she will work with Transport Scotland to ensure that there are these evening services, and does she think that this service is adequate for my constituents?
First Minister.
It's important that people in all parts of the country have access to real services that are appropriate, so I certainly agree on that general point. I'm happy to raise this issue with Transport Scotland and come back to the member in due course.
Michael Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My constituent, Ryan Caswell, has been a resident patient in Carsview Mental Health Unit in Dundee for 2 years and 3 months as a result of delayed discharge. Ryan has autism spectrum disorder and learning disabilities. Ryan's parents are beside themselves with worry due to the lack of appropriate medical care being provided to their son. They fear for his life. Ryan struggles to communicate. For much of the last year, he has been crying out in severe pain, which has led only to restraints and sedation. After many months of suffering without help, he had 5 impacted molars removed. The staff available to him do not have sufficient medical training to diagnose patients in their care. Presiding officer, there have been 2 damning reports into mental health services in Tayside. The second of the Strang reports has been described to me as the most worrying report in Scottish public life. This has gone on for years as people suffer and people die. First Minister, when will it change?
First Minister.
Firstly, these are really important issues. The Independent Oversight Group for Mental Health in Tayside is providing scrutiny and assurance on the implementation of the Trust and Respect recommendations to improve mental health, and that group continues to work with partners, third sector and people with lived experience to deliver improvements to mental health services and achieve outcomes that local communities and individuals have a right to expect. I'm not familiar with all of the details of Ryan's case. From what has been described there, it sounds to me to be unacceptable. I think in fairness to Ryan and to his parents, who are understandably anxious and distressed, I want to look further into that. When I've had the opportunity to do so, I or the Health Secretary will reply in more detail to the member.
Eleanor Whittam.
To ask the First Minister if she shares my disgust at the comments made by Tory MP Lee Anderson in the House of Commons that those who are using food banks across these islands do so because they cannot cook and they cannot budget, and that this demonstrates clearly that the Tories are completely out of touch with those suffering from the cost of living crisis that they created.
First Minister.
These comments were despicable and disgusting. It seems to me that every time a Tory MP opens their mouth right now, they simply demonstrate how out of touch they are with the suffering of too many people across Scotland and the entire UK. People are having to go to food banks not because they can't cook. People are having to go to food banks right now because they don't have enough money to feed themselves and their children. My government is and will continue to do everything we can to get money into the pockets of the lowest income families across the country, the Scottish Child Payment being the chief example of that. But it is well past time that the Prime Minister, the Chancellor and the UK government stood up, stepped up and took action to get money into the pockets of those who need it to stop people having to make decisions about heating their homes or feeding their children.
Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, midwifery services across Scotland are at breaking point. A survey conducted by the Royal College of Midwives has revealed that 3/4 of midwives in Scotland are thinking of leaving the profession due to understaffing, burnout and fears they cannot provide safe care. Despite the Scottish Government providing £12 million of funding to support the mental health and well-being of the workforce, this is clearly having little effect. First Minister, lives of women and babies are at risk. This is not safe, this is not sustainable, and this is not acceptable. So what urgent action can the Scottish Government put in place to rectify this situation?
First Minister.
Midwives play a key role in making sure that women receive the care they need when they need it, and we value the role of the RCM and its members, the role they have played in our ongoing response to the pandemic. The Health Secretary actually met with the RCM this week to discuss the report and its recommendations, and we will continue to work with the RCM and midwives generally to address the pressures that they and other health professionals are working under. Of course, overall nursing and midwifery staffing in Scotland is at a record high. It has increased by 14.5% since this government took office, that is the facts of the matter. But of course, all of our health professionals are working under extreme pressure, and through our investment, support and reforms, we will continue to support them in the invaluable job that they do.
Carol Mockin.
Thank you. The First Minister will be aware that this week is Mental Health Awareness Week, with a focus on loneliness. Findings from the Mental Health Foundation showed that in Scotland, 25% of people surveyed had felt lonely some or all of the time over the previous month. And concerningly, 31% of people said feelings of loneliness had negatively impacted on their mental health. Action is needed. And despite having 15 years in office, the government have failed to deliver an effective mental health strategy that supports the well-being of the Scottish population. Why has the First Minister failed so badly in this regard, and what steps can she set out today, both in prevention and intervention, to address the crisis that is in our mental health services?
First Minister.
Mental health is and will continue to be a priority. As I've said many times in this chamber, the fact that more people feel able to come forward with mental health problems now is something that we should continue to support, but we must make sure the services are there for them when they need them. The focus, of course, of Mental Health Awareness Week is loneliness and isolation. In that regard, the Scottish Government is supporting a range of work. Last year, we provided more than £20 million to local communities through the Community's Mental Health and Wellbeing Fund for Adults. Earlier this month, we announced that a further £15 million would be available in this financial year. That fund is supporting almost 2,000 local community projects, many of them addressing loneliness and isolation, and we're investing £10 million over the course of this Parliament specifically to tackle social isolation and loneliness. So we will continue to make the investments and do everything we can to support the many organisations across the country that do such good work.
Question number 3, Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister when the Cabinet will next meet.
First Minister.
Tuesday.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful for that reply. Presiding Officer, raw sewage is released into our rivers every single day. It is routinely dumped by Scotland's government-owned water company. Thanks to investigations by the Ferret, we now know that this happened more than 10,000 times last year. That's 30 times a day. Scottish Water is only required to monitor 3% of sewage release points, so the true figure will be much, much worse. Scotland is way behind England on this. This is an SNP Green coalition that claims to champion the environment, but the Environment Minister herself described the routine dumping of untreated human waste in our rivers as vital. Presiding Officer, this shouldn't be allowed to happen. We're talking about excrement, wet wipes, sanitary towels. In West Edinburgh, right now, there are otters, fish, children and dogs playing in the River Almond, where sewage has been dumped hundreds of times. So can I ask the First Minister, why aren't there targets to end the release of sewage into our rivers, and how long does she plan to allow this to continue?
First Minister.
This is an important issue that Alex Cole-Hamilton has raised. The cleanliness of our rivers and our seas is of paramount importance, and how we deal with waste of all forms in our country, of course, is a big issue, a big challenge for governments everywhere. I have not, my apologies to Alex Cole-Hamilton, I have not seen the investigation by the Ferret. I will take steps to ensure that I do see that, and I'll come back to him with more detail about what the government is doing and what more the government needs to do, like all governments across the world, to tackle what is a serious issue.
Question number 4, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what the Scottish Government's response is to the report published last Friday, Owning the Future, a framework of regulations for decarbonising owner-occupied homes in Scotland, commissioned by the Existing Homes Alliance.
First Minister.
The Scottish Government welcomes the publication of this research by the Existing Homes Alliance. Heating our homes and places of work is the third largest cause of emissions in Scotland. In light of this, our Heat and Buildings strategy, published in October, set out over 100 different actions to support households and businesses to make energy efficiency improvements and transition from fossil fuel heating systems. The strategy includes a commitment to regulate for minimum standards in homes, and we'll consult in detail on our proposed approach in the coming year. The Existing Homes Alliance and others have worked positively and constructively with us on this to date, and we'll continue to engage with the organisation and others as we finalise our approach.
Kenneth Gibson.
I thank the First Minister for her detailed reply. This is a highly complex area with very detailed recommendations, including the need for legislation if we're fully to decarbonise our buildings by 2045. Scottish solutions identified in the report include the installation of low-temperature heat pumps, district heating and, for some homes, biomass boilers. The key driver will be improving building fabric efficiency. Can the First Minister confirm that as we focus more on decarbonisation, her government will prioritise a fabric-first approach, introduce a fabric energy efficiency standard, begin the phase-out of fossil fuels for heating, and act to ensure we have the skilled workers in our communities necessary to deliver on our vital climate change targets?
First Minister.
We have a very long-standing commitment to a fabric-first approach. That's critical to reducing demand, making homes warmer and preparing them for zero emissions technologies. We've committed to regulating minimum energy efficiency standards in homes by 2033. The standard will be equivalent to EPC C, reformed to focus on fabric measures. Fabric improvement alone, though, will not get us close to net zero. We need a strong focus on heating system change. We'll phase out the need to install newer replacement fossil fuel boilers in off-gas from 2025 and in on-gas areas from 2030. The opportunity presented by the heat transition will require further capability and capacity in our supply chains. So we're also developing a new heat and building supply chain delivery plan with industry so that we can deliver this work at the pace and the scale that is needed.
Daniel Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank Kenny Gibson for raising this? Because 28% of people in Scotland live in tenemented dwellings. The proportion is even higher in my constituency. On page 3 of the report, it sets out very clearly that we need to look at existing forms of heating beyond air source heat pumps because they quite simply will not work for people in tenemented dwellings. Likewise, the legal framework right now makes it difficult for tenement owners to do the sorts of retrofitting required. So will the Scottish Government give consideration to plans for investment in municipal heat networks and for a change in the law to make it easier for tenement owners to come together to fit the retrofitting that they require to heat homes sustainably, even for people living in tenemented dwellings?
First Minister.
Yes, we will do all of that, and I certainly have a lot of sympathy with the points made. I also represent a constituency, albeit in a different city that has a high number of tenemental properties within it. In terms of the heat network fund, the £300 million heat network fund, that will support both large networks suited to urban environments as well as small rural and community-led heat networks and communal systems. So these are complex issues. I recognise that, I think, in my response to Kenny Gibson, and they are issues that we are working through in partnership with industry. But it's important that all of these points are borne in mind as we continue to do so.
Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The cost of the heat and building strategy is £33 billion. This government has offered £1.8 billion towards it. Who will pay the rest?
First Minister.
I think Liam Kerr should know the process that we have underway right now. Of course, the £1.8 billion is over the course of this Parliament. That is significant investment. It will support those least able to pay. It will support our Scotland's Heat Network Fund, the Social Housing Net Zero Heat Fund, for example. But we have also established the Green Heat Finance Task Force to recommend ways to increase private sector investment and to look, of course, at contributions from individuals, which we all want to keep to a minimum. As the Minister set out when he launched the strategy, this will require us to lever significant private capital investment. As I was at the All Energy Conference yesterday and heard Keith Anderson of Scottish Power make this point. The good news is there is significant amounts of private capital looking for ways to invest in the net zero transition. So the task force has an important job to do, and that work is underway.
Question number 5, Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what meetings the Scottish Government has had with the private and voluntary nursery sector regarding delivery of its early learning and childcare strategy.
First Minister.
We continue to engage with the childcare sector in open and constructive discussions as we develop a new strategic plan for our childcare commitments for the remainder of this Parliament. Providers in the private, third and child-minding sectors are playing a crucial role in the successful delivery of the transformational 1,140 hours offer, through which over 111,000 children are accessing high-quality funded early learning and childcare. Scotland has the highest ELC funding rates across the UK as a result of the expansion. Average rates paid to providers for 3 to 5 year olds receiving funded ELC have increased by 48% between 2017 and 2021. So we continue to work closely with partners in local government to ensure that providers are paid sustainable rates that reflect the cost of delivery.
Megan Gallagher.
Scottish Conservative MSPs have met with concerned nurseries across the PVI sector who have continuously raised concerns over the relationship with local authorities. We have tried to arrange a meeting with the Minister of Children and Young People to raise these concerns on their behalf, in particular the funding formula that creates inequality between local authorities and the PVI sector. Regretfully, the Minister has now rescheduled 2 meetings that were due to take place. First Minister, these matters are pressing. So if the Minister cannot meet with concerned MSPs, will you?
First Minister.
Scottish Government officials have already met with representatives of the Ambition 1140 Hours group recently to discuss specifically their concerns. A commitment has been given to a further meeting in the near future to continue these discussions, and of course there will be ministerial engagement as required. I think it is important to recognise that the funding agreement between the Scottish Government and COSLA, supporting the expansion that has been delivered so far, allows local authorities to pay sustainable rates to private and third sector nurseries who provide free early learning and childcare places, and also to childminders. But I know there are concerns, and we want to address those. The financial sustainability health check that was published in August 2021 found that 88% of private and third sector providers delivering funded ELC plan to pay all staff in their setting the real living wage from August last year, and that compares to a position before the expansion in 2016 where around 80% of practitioners were paid less than the living wage at the time. Of course, public funding accounts for around 33 to 45% of overall income for private childcare services. The majority also provide private services, so there are bigger issues here that need to be addressed, but we will continue to engage with those in that sector and have a determination to do so.
Natalie Dawn.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. With energy bills and inflation skyrocketing unchecked by the UK Tory government, thousands of parents are having to resort to skipping meals to ensure their children can get fed first. Can I ask the First Minister, as more and more young families struggle to stay afloat through the cost of living crisis, what further action the Scottish Government is taking to help new parents make ends meet so that neither them or their children need to go hungry?
First Minister, but I would remind members of the need to ensure that supplementaries do reflect the substantive question.
It is a really important issue. The difficulty people are having feeding their children right now is perhaps one of the most important issues that any politician and any government has to address. And actually, the free childcare expansion is very relevant here because it is worth up to almost £5,000, £4,900 each year for eligible children. So it is one of the significant interventions that this government has made. In addition to that, of course, our five family benefits includes the Scottish Child Payment, now £20 per week, and set to extend to under 16s and rise to £25 per week by the end of this year.
Willie Rennie.
The problem is that there is a massive exodus of staff from the private and voluntary sector as a result of the fact that those nurseries can't compete with the wages from the council because there is not a fair funding formula. This has a direct impact on the capacity, but also on the flexibility that the First Minister will remember that she promised that there would be available for parents across the country. This situation is stark now. So will the First Minister intervene and fix this situation?
First Minister. Well,
the fact of the matter is parents across the country have more childcare, funded childcare available and available more flexibly. And the funding agreement between the Scottish Government and COSLA to support the expansion did allow local authorities to pay sustainable rates. I have recognised, however, the issues that those in the private and voluntary sectors are facing, and I've given a commitment that we will continue to engage with them to seek to address them.
Question number six, Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister whether the Scottish Government will convene an emergency summit on abortion healthcare in response to anti-abortion rights action in Scotland and around the world.
First Minister.
Women have the right to access abortion without fear or intimidation. To that end, let me say again to anyone wanting to protest against abortion, do it outside Parliament. Protesting outside hospitals or sexual health clinics targets women, not lawmakers, and it causes stress and anxiety to those accessing health care. That, in my view, is deeply wrong. I strongly support the introduction of buffer zones, and the government is actively considering how this Parliament can legislate in a way that is effective and also capable of withstanding legal challenge. I'm also aware that Gillian Mackay may shortly consult on a member's bill. On that latter point about legality, members will be aware that the law on buffer zones passed in Northern Ireland has recently been referred to the Supreme Court. The outcome of that may have relevance for any steps we take here. In the meantime, though, as we consider and hopefully resolve issues around national legislation, we will support any local authority that is willing to use bylaws to establish buffer zones. Finally, Presiding Officer, I am very happy to convene, and indeed I will personally chair a roundtable summit to discuss buffer zones and indeed any other matters that need to be addressed to ensure safe and timely access to abortion services in Scotland within the current law.
Monica Lennon.
Thank you. I warmly welcome the First Minister's agreement to convene an urgent summit that more than a dozen women's organisations have called for, and her personal commitment to chair the talks and facilitate politicians, campaigners and healthcare experts working together is hugely important, and I thank her for this. Does the First Minister agree that we must use this forum to actively demonstrate our solidarity with women in America and around the world who fear their legal rights are slipping away, whilst urgently taking action to deal with the challenges facing those accessing and providing abortion healthcare here in Scotland? And while operational policing matters are for Police Scotland, does she agree that it is important that any members of the public experiencing harassment or intimidation when seeking to access or provide abortion healthcare must feel confident that if they come forward to the police with any complaints, that they will be properly investigated?
First Minister.
I agree with all of that, but let me very briefly, Presiding Officer, try to address each of the points made. Firstly, I do agree, and I do agree that it is important to show solidarity on these issues, that the attack we are seeing on abortion rights, and let's call that for what it is, that's an attack on the right of women to control our own bodies. The attack we are seeing chiefly in the United States as a result of the concern about the overturning of Roe v. Wade, but we are seeing that in other countries, is deeply concerning. And I believe in a woman's right to choose, and I believe those of us who hold that view have a duty to show solidarity with those in other parts of the world where it is coming under most significant attack. On the issue of police powers, of course, these are operational matters for the police, and it would be wrong for me to say how the police should use these powers, but there are powers under antisocial behaviour legislation that are there for the police should they judge that it is appropriate to use them. But finally, Presiding Officer, everybody without exception should have the right to access healthcare without fear and intimidation. And that applies to any woman, and no woman does this lightly, but that applies to any woman seeking to access abortion services completely within the law. So again, I say to those who want to protest, it is in a democracy absolutely a right to protest. But come to Parliament and protest against lawmakers. Do not cause women fear, anxiety and intimidation.
John Mason.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the First Minister if there's going to be a summit on abortion healthcare, would the 24-week limit be under review? Because I think science and medicine have moved on since 1990 and many children are surviving at 23 weeks.
First Minister.
No, that would not be on the agenda of the summit I have agreed to convene today. I do not support a reduction in the current time limit for abortion. On the contrary, actually, I think the challenge in Scotland is to ensure that women who need to, and let me repeat, that is something no woman does lightly, can access that right in a safe and timely manner.
Julian Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As we've heard the First Minister will be aware of the loud protests outside the Sandyford Clinic in Glasgow yesterday. Not only do these protests intimidate many of the people who use these services, clinicians have contacted me to say it also forced the clinic to close particular rooms on one side of the building due to the amplification system the protesters were using. As part of the summit that the First Minister has just committed to, would the First Minister ensure that clinical representatives and trade unions are present, as well as patients' representatives, to ensure that clinicians are not subject to harassment when simply doing their jobs?
First Minister.
Yes, I'll give that commitment. I would also take the opportunity to pay tribute to Gillian Mackay for the work she has done in this, and I hope she will agree to take part in the summit that we're talking about today. In terms of the protests outside the Sandyford Clinic, even if it was only providing abortion services, these protests, in my view, would be wrong because they cause women intimidation and anxiety. But there's a range of sexual health services provided by the Sandyford Clinic. The last thing anybody should be doing is making it harder for people to access those and making it harder for clinicians to go about the jobs they do. So I will appeal again, Presiding Officer, to those who want to protest. And let me underline this. It is a right in a democracy to protest. I am not questioning that in any way, shape or form. But the place to protest is where the laws are made. The people to protest to are us, parliamentarians, lawmakers. Allow people to exercise the right to access healthcare in the way all of us have a right to do, without any fear and intimidation and without added stress and anxiety. That is the decent thing to do.
That concludes First Minister's questions. The next item of business is a member's business debate in the name of Maggie Chapman.